and the Alston Brighton District City Councilor. Today is Monday, May 9th. I am here with several of my colleagues to review the Boston Transportation Department FY17 budget. I'd like to remind folks that this is a public hearing and is being recorded and broadcast on both Comcast Channel 8 and RCN Channel 82. I've asked people in the chambers to silence their electronic devices. At the conclusion of BTD's presentation, question and answers from my colleagues, we will take public testimony at that time, and would appreciate it if anyone in the chamber wishes to testify publicly. There's a sign-in sheet by the front door to my left. I'd ask that you state your name, affiliation, and residence, and please limit your comments to a few minutes to ensure that all comments and concerns can be heard. We will also take up to 10 people for online testimony via Google Hangouts at each hearing after in-person testimony. The link to sign up for online testimony is boston.gov/citycouncil/google.asp. Today's hearing is regarding dockets 0525 through 0527, 0537, and 0543. Orders for the fiscal year 17 operating budget, including annual appropriation and tax order, annual appropriation for the school department, appropriation for other post-employment benefits, appropriation for certain park improvements, and appropriation for certain bridge improvements. Also, capital dockets 0528 through 0532, 0534 through 0536, and 0538 through 0542. Orders for the fiscal year 17 capital budget, including loan orders, appropriation, amending previous loan orders, and lease and purchase agreements. I am joined in order of their arrival by several of my colleagues, Councilor Tim McCarthy to my left, Councilor Sal LaMartina to my immediate left, Councilor Bill Linehan to my right, and Councilor Josh Zakim to my left. At this point, I'm going to hand it over to Commissioner Biandaka and her team. Thank you for coming and welcome.
Thank you, Councilor. On behalf of the Transportation Department, I'm pleased to be here and thank you for the opportunity. I'd like to take a moment and introduce the team that I've assembled here. To my right is Coleman Flaherty, BTD's Budget Director. To my immediate left is Greg Rooney, BTD's Enforcement Director. And to his left is Vineet Gupta, BTD's Director of Planning. On behalf of the men and women of the Transportation Department, I'm pleased and honored to represent them here today and to present our FY17 budget proposal. As you know, BTD is a complex agency with a wide range of responsibilities carried out by several different divisions within the department. Our engineering division and policy and planning division, which includes Boston Bikes, is located in our main administrative office in room 721 of Boston City Hall, adjacent to the Traffic Management Center. The Office of the Parking Clerk is housed in room 224 of City Hall. The Operations Division is located at Channel Street and continues to undergo structural improvements since we took over that space last year. And BTD's Enforcement Division is at the city's tow lot at 200 Frontage Road with administrative offices at 300 Frontage Road. Together, BTD staff from these various divisions work to ensure that Boston's streets are safe and efficient for all modes of travel, and that our curb space best balances the needs of both our residential and business communities. In addition, we are continuing to strive to ensure that we are taking advantage of current technology to improve both customer service and operations. In the past year, BTD has worked side by side with neighborhood residents and the businesses' communities to provide constituents with quality transportation services and plan for future improvements. I'd like to mention a few of our accomplishments. The Boston 2030 Citywide Transportation Plan engaged over 6,000 Bostonians, and their participation helped in the production of a visioning framework that was released this past fall. In addition, we collected over 3,500 project and policy ideas from the public in 2016 to develop the Go Boston 2030 Action Plan to be released this coming fall. Mayor Walsh appointed a Vision Zero interagency task force led by BTD with Boston Police, EMS, and the Public Health Commission. The task force recently released an action plan and completed early action items, including the installation of 7 speed radar signs in the neighborhoods, a protected bike lane at Mass Ave and Beacon Streets, a 20-mile-per-hour safety zone on Norfolk Street, lead pedestrian interval traffic signals at several intersections, and the development of a safety concerns online map that has seen thousands of entries from the public. Community processes are ongoing at 2 neighborhood slow streets pilot areas, Stony Brook and Jamaica Plain, and the Talbot-Norfolk Triangle in Dorchester. The improvements will include traffic calming measures on residential streets in these zones. This year, we added 15 new bike stations to the New Balance Hubway Bike Share Program, including the first locations in Brighton and significant expansions into parts of Dorchester, Charlestown, and Roxbury. In April 2016, we announced further expansion that will take place this summer with 10 new stations in Roxbury and North Dorchester. The popular bike share system recently recorded 4 million trips taken by Hubway users since its launch in 2011. Additional Boston Bikes-related improvements this past year include 6 miles of new bike lanes, bringing the total bike lanes in Boston to 104 miles. 6,200 youngsters were trained at 33 sites via the youth cycling program, and 85% of these children were in the 8th grade or lower. 176 new bike racks were installed, bringing the total number to nearly 2,000 citywide. $5 Hubway subsidized memberships were provided to 500 people in Boston, and via the Roll It Forward program, we distributed 540 abandoned bikes repaired through 48 organizations this year. And it's important to note that since 2010, 4,400 bikes have been distributed through Boston Bikes programs, with 50% given to children under the age of 12. BTD conducted development reviews to sign 29 transportation access plan agreements in 2015. Each project involves the negotiation of mitigation by developers, including new traffic signals, funds for street design, and bicycle parking. BTD organized the community process and interagency review of conceptual designs for the following projects: Melnia Cass Boulevard, Hyde Square and Monument Square, and the Center South Streets corridor, and Central Square, Audubon Circle, and Connect Historic Boston are in construction in FY16. We rolled out Drive Boston, our car share initiative. The partnership with Zipcar and Enterprise provides for 80 car share vehicles around the city, especially in communities with limited car share opportunities. The Park Boston meter payment application was implemented and named the 2015 Favorite New Mobile Service by Beta Boston and the year's Best Tech Products Report. In the Office of the Parking Clerk, we introduced Skype hearings for out-of-state motorists who want to contest a parking ticket. We implemented a game day $100 parking fine program for the Fenway resident parking neighborhood. Residents reported more compliance with game day parking once the parking fine exceeded parking lot rates. We collaborated with Public Works to test a new approach to street cleaning in Charlestown. Ticket fines increased to $90 from $40, and towing was eliminated. We developed the Municipal Parking Lot Improvement Program and applied it to the management of 32 neighborhood parking lots, which provide a total of 1,375 parking spaces in Boston's neighborhoods. We also initiated the reconstruction of the River Street lot in Mattapan. We expanded resident parking programs, which were completed in Roxbury, West Roxbury, Jamaica Plain, Roslindale, Dorchester, South Boston, and East Boston. We implemented a traffic signal inventory system by preparing and uploading 833 intersections as built plans into a document management system. We also advanced to 75% the design plans for our 10 traffic signal intersection project. And we also implemented technology at 3 schools so that school zone traffic signals can be updated and changed remotely. For B Park, which is our database of parking and traffic regulations, we selected a vendor, Street Park LLC, as the successful proposer. Design and data collection have commenced already for this. We successfully coordinated the last-minute redesign of the Commonwealth Ave Phase 2A reconstruction project to include protected cycle tracks and secured all right-of-way certificates required to receive our $18 million in federal and state construction funding. We collaborated with the Boston Public Works Department to design and construct neighborhood traffic safety improvement project at 7 different intersections. Roadway modifications included bump outs, ADA compliant ramps, and more. We also collaborated with the Public Works Department to develop designs with the community for Audubon Circle, Central Square in East Boston, Hyde Park and Monument Squares in Jamaica Plain, and Dudley and Melney as CAS. BTD consulted extensively with MassDOT and various state agencies on design planning for state projects such as the Longfellow Bridge, the Casey Overpass removal, Alston I-90 grounding, Wynn Casino, elimination of Sumner Tunnel Toll Plaza, and we are an active stakeholder in the South Boston Waterfront Transportation Access Plan. And early action items for that plan were eliminated, such as the opening of the South Boston Bypass Road to general traffic in the morning. For FY17, our goals include initiating demand-based pricing pilot program for parking meters, developing a vendor validation program for Park Boston application, and in cooperation with the BRA, BTD will begin working on a transportation action plan for the area around North Station, the West End, Bullfinch Triangle, and Government Center. The plan will include a comprehensive analysis of the existing transportation network, as well as potential near and long-term improvements across various types of transit. BTD will continue to work with MassDOT on several reconstruction projects, including the Casey Overpass, the Longfellow Bridge, Mass Ave Symphony Hall area, the Sumner Tunnel Toll Plaza demolition, 10 intersections project, Comm Ave Phase 2, North Washington Street Bridge, Commonwealth Ave Bridge over I-90, the Mass Ave Bridge over Comm Ave, and more. BTD will design and implement new traffic signal timing plans for 60 intersections as part of the signal retiming program, and install 25 new controllers at key intersections. We will work to complete the B Park project to document traffic and parking regulations throughout the city, and work with PWD on capital construction projects, including Connect Historic Boston, Central Square, Harrison Ave, Dudley Square, Quincy Street, Comm Ave Phase 3, and North Square. We begin construction for joint transportation and public works signal construction projects for 5 intersections this year. And we're continuing to work with the MBTA on transit signal priority. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present our FY17 budget. And on behalf of the men and women of the Transportation Department, we are pleased to be here today to answer any questions that you have regarding our budget.
Thank you, Commissioner. And let me recognize that we've been joined by City Councilor-at-Large Anissa Sabi George, Councilor Andrea Campbell, Ayanna Presley, and Frank Baker. Thanks. And just wanted to recognize a few people who aren't here. You have some of your superstars here with Greg Coleman and Vineet, but wanted to mention Kevin Donahue, Paul Lee, the people out that, you know, we work with every day, Danny Nozzo, Donnie Keogh, Brian McKinley, Bill Conroy, Jim Galulli, Don Burgess, John DeBenedictis, Willie Dupree, Mike Devine and Teresa Wolfel, just to name a few. I just wanted to say that, you know, my office is in constant contact with every department, but particularly the transportation department, to keep things moving, and thank you and your team for that. Just jumping right into the permanent employees line, 51,000. There's been a decrease to basically level funding. I know that has to impact, you know, the number of employees. Can you walk me through your FTEs and any changes and kind of reorgs that the department has gone through?
Sure, I'd be happy to answer that question, Counselor. So part of the central process for the budget office was they were looking to eliminate long-term vacancies in departments. So we've actually reduced our headcount quota by 37 long-term vacancies. 29 of those positions were parking enforcement officers, which were vacants. The headcount had initially been bumped up several years ago, and we took on some additional staff with when the cadet program was eliminated at Boston Police Department. We took on some additional staff then, and previous to that, even when the printing department was closed. So mm-hmm. those FTE positions were bumped up. Now that they've been vacant for a while, through attrition and retirements and other, they've been reduced in the headcount. So although the staffing looks level, it should be sufficient.
Right, and probably accounts for contracts, collective bargaining increases and such?
There's no collective bargaining increase budgeted. Yes, I believe that's going to be handled centrally.
Okay,
with the budget off.
All right. Also, looking at the overtime budget, and I think the historical overtime expenditure has been where you're projecting it to be. So is that kind of like more, we see the police department and the fire department both go to more realistic numbers. Is that an attempt? Is that kind of like a policy now?
Exactly. This dollar amount should more accurately reflect the actual spending. Mm-hmm. We do have initiatives to try to reduce the overall number of hours of overtime with a goal of a reduction of 5% mm-hmm. in the hours.
Okay. And in the information you provided us, I see that you're about $900 million year to date, or near the end of March, in overtime, but that doesn't include some...
900 million would be a big number.
I'm sorry. 900,000, sorry. And so the...
Correct.
There's no charge back.
Correct.
Can you explain that?
Yes. Included in that number are charges for instance, snow and weather-related overtime that eventually gets moved back to the public works gotcha. Snow account.
Right.
There's also some overtime for street repaving, which we will transfer back to Public Works, and those transfers okay. get processed prior to year end.
Gotcha.
So you'll see a reduction in that right. number.
And then line 52,200 utilities under contractual services has increased by almost a half a million. Can you kind of walk me through that?
Certainly. The transportation department last year took on the staff from the signal shop, which had previously been located with street lighting and public works. So the personnel and the headcount moved last year. The numbers this year in that utilities line include the charges for the cost of power for the traffic signals throughout the city. That okay. charge didn't move back to our budget last year. It's moving this year. So that's why you see that substantial increase.
Okay.
There'll be an offsetting reduction in the public works budget.
Okay. And that is contracted to vendors then to do the signal timing?
No. This is the NSTAR. This is the power
oh,
for the
power.
Signals.
Yeah,
yes.
Okay.
Utilities.
Gotcha.
Costs.
So
yes,
we're
sorry.
take BTD is taking it on from
BTD is taking the charge from Public Works.
Gotcha. Okay. And could you just give us the most recent update on Connect Boston? I know that that's in construction now, and any updates on that beneath that?
Sure. Thank you, Counselor. The project is under construction. It's being managed by the Public Works Department, and it should be substantially complete next year.
Next year?
Yeah.
Okay. This time next year?
Yeah. And, you know, I would defer to the Public Works Department to give you an accurate update.
Okay.
And I'm happy to do that and report back.
That would be great. Okay. And the ComAv Phase 2, is that, I thought I heard that that was being delayed a little. Is that?
Yeah, I can check on that. I'm
could
not
aware. You? Thanks.
Absolutely.
Okay. Great. Okay, at this time, let me recognize Councilor Tim McCarthy.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And thank you very much, Commissioner and staff, for being here today. Mark went through the whole list of people we want to thank. You know, I deal mainly with Kevin Donahue and Brian McKinley. I wanted to make sure I give them, you know, their props. Always calling me back right away and being incredibly helpful to my staff. I do want to thank the public, the Transportation Department in general for the continued support of my recommendations for Cleary Square and Hyde Park Main Streets. The changes that we've made with working with Vineet, first time in 30 years we have single-digit vacancies in Main Streets and Hyde Park, and I believe it's a direct direct relationship with the changes that Vineet made with changing Harvard Ave to a two-way and flipping the traffic over. And saying that it's single-digit vacancies in 30 years is really not a small thing. So I really want to thank Vineet and his hard work in Hyde Park Main Streets. And now I'm going to ask Vineet for some more help. of course, you know, you guys run a very tight ship in going over this budget. There's not a lot of fat on this. So let me just get right into a question. Walcott Square, as you know, Vineet, the coming through Walcott Square and Reedville and up over that bridge, Jim Galluli's been a great friend in advocating for some changes over there. Is at some point we can get in touch with MassDOT. I know we have a mutual friend at MassDOT. Maybe it could help us. That intersection is a hodgepodge of state and city-owned roads.
Yeah.
Where you go from city to state, back to state, back to city, and it's, but the traffic is, it's over the top. And at this time, we have a lot of developers looking at stretches of land down in that area, which I think arguably could help our neighborhood in a good way, bringing more people and more foot traffic. But literally from, with the 300 buses down there, from about 6:15 in the morning till 8 o'clock, it can sometimes take you 15 minutes just to get from one side of Reedville to the other. And I think it's because the lights in Walcott Square are probably put in there like 1950-something. So at some point in time, we can get together with MassDOT, maybe take a walk out there and see if we can insist that MassDOT sink a little money, and maybe we could do a little something out there as well.
Yeah, we'll be happy to coordinate that walkthrough. We think it's really necessary to do that. While there may be some long-term issues with MassDOT and the city of Boston implementing things, if there are short-term things that BTD can do to improve traffic flow, you know, we don't have to wait to do endless coordination. We can try and do that straight away.
Yeah, and thank you very much. And I see that you put more money in the budget for the radar speed signs. You know, I love them. So I've got a couple requests in for them. I know you have to kind of seed the infield. I get it. But if you have any looking for District 5, we'd appreciate it. But other than that, it's a really tight budget, and I've always appreciated everything that the Basic City Services team does for my office and in my community. So thank you very much, Commissioner.
Thank you, Councilor.
Thank you.
Thanks,
thank
Mark.
You. Councilor LaMartina.
Good morning, Commissioner.
Good morning.
And to your staff. And
I just want to recognize Councilor Tito Jackson has joined us. Thank you.
Thank you again for your staff.
Thank you, Councilor.
Please let Stephen Pascantilli know that our thoughts are with him and his family right now. Stephen had a fire last night at his house on Hanover Street. So our thoughts are with him. He does a great job at operations. Let me just say I'm a little disappointed with your budget. All right. And I hate to be really hard but I come from the transportation department. So when I hear that you are not going to fund 37 long-term positions, 29 of them in the meters and enforcement officers, does not make sense to me. Does not make sense to me. Because right now, the focus is on street cleaning, street cleaning, street cleaning. But because we have shortage in enforcement officers, the public safety does not get done. I hear it all the time in the North End, and I'm not really happy about it. It just does not make sense to me. And I'd like to know the other eight positions. Where's the other eight positions that are not being funded?
They're throughout the rest of the department, primarily clerical-type positions.
How about operations? You just go over the staff into operations?
Pardon me?
I'd like to know the full-time employees in operations.
Sure, I can provide you a roster.
Can you
of
please?
That. Yes.
And this is the last time I'm going to talk about meters. I'm sick of talking about meters. I've been talking about meters since 2001 when I worked at operations. I just don't understand why we can't work to keep the meters running till at least 2 o'clock in the morning. It will bring in revenues to our city. Right now, they close at 8 o'clock. Every time I go to a city, the first thing I do is I look at the meters. You go to Brookline, their game days, they charge like $6 an hour at the meters. We should be doing that. That's money that we could be using in the parks department or other departments. So I just don't understand it. You'll never hear me talk about meters again as long as I'm on the city council, because by right, when you're an elected official and your politics is don't talk about meters or revenues, that's like a tax, and people don't like that. But this is for the city of Boston. When you're cutting staffing levels, enforcement office, enforcement and meters, it just doesn't make sense. On that note, Vinny, can you talk a little about BTD's role at the Board of Appeals?
Councilor, could I just take a moment to respond to
do you want to
your
respond?
About the
sure.
parking meters? We certainly appreciate your advocacy for our meter program. Public safety is certainly our number one priority in the transportation department. And with regard to the meter program, we were pleased to announce this year that we recently completed installation of all new meter technology in the city, as well as the completion of our Park Boston payment app. That technology will give us the opportunity to take a hard look at the meter program and our occupancy rate and our availability of curbside capacity. So with that technology and the numbers and the data that we're able to analyze in a very meaningful way, we'll be happy to engage the conversation with you regarding our meter program.
Thank you. I would love to see that. Can I ask you one question about the meters?
Yes.
I know when I worked down there, they used to put a piece of paper in there and the meter would go out. Do they still do that?
We've come a long way since then,
oh,
Councilor. Each and
that.
Every meter in the city has two payment options. You can pay by coins, you can pay by quarters and a dollar coin. You can also pay with a credit card at each and every meter, and each and every metered space in the city also accepts the Park Boston app.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And you're doing a great job.
Thank you, Councilor.
And you have come a long way since I worked out there. Vinny, can you talk a little about BTD's role at the Board of Appeals?
Sure, I'm happy to do that, Councilor. We have one representative who attends every ZBA hearing.
Yep.
In advance of that hearing, on cases that are directly related to transportation, we do a technical analysis, and we liaison with the Mayor's Office of Neighborhood Services. So we understand both community issues as well as if there are any kind of more mechanical and technical issues that need to be addressed. And based on that analysis, in advance of the ZBA hearing when that case is heard, our representative, if necessary, makes a comment here. So that's the process we've been following. We are happy to kind of accommodate our any recommendations you have to improve the process.
So you're working with the applicant?
Yes.
So before they go to the Board of Appeals, they already know the concerns about transportation concerns?
In most cases, yes.
In most cases,
yes.
Thank you. So you need to spend some time up there, I think. In regards to the resident parking program, Commissioner, I want to thank you and your team. Eagle Hill has been working. There's a couple of changes that we need to put some times on. I'll talk to you later. Stephen's not here today.
Thank you, Councilor, for your leadership on that.
But thank you for working with that neighborhood, because my phone's not ringing off the wall. And you live in East Boston, you know how that. The North Washington Street Bridge, finally, can you give us a little update where we are in that?
Sure. That project is under design.
Yep.
And so there's a joint team consisting of the Public Works Department, the Transportation Department, and of course, Mass DOT. So we're finalizing. We're at a, I would say, more at a 50% design for the North Washington Street Bridge. And, you know, once the design is complete, we'll it'll be funded. Of course, I should mention that Public Works Department is the lead.
Yes.
And I'm sure they'll be able to give you a more accurate update.
So my concern on the North Washington Street Bridge is very simple. We need three lanes inbound, because traffic in Charlestown is it's a mess at rush hour in the mornings, in the afternoons. So we need, as a transportation department, I think you really need to look at making that three lane, at least on the inbound.
Yeah. And actually, as you know, Councillor, when you look at traffic flow, it's the most important thing is what happens at the intersection when motor vehicles and pedestrians and those on bicycles and those in buses approach. The current design actually has four lanes approaching the intersection at Keeney Square.
Yep.
So because there's a fairly significant right turn, a fairly significant left turn, and then we have two through lanes.
Two lanes.
So there's a total of four lanes as you approach the Keeney Square intersection coming over the bridge. We want to make sure as well that those who are on bicycles are accommodated. So there's also space for a off-road protected bike lane, yep, on the bridge. And we also want to make sure that people in buses are given priority.
Sure. I know I'm over my time. Yeah, I just want to give a shout out to the enforcement division, the Irenes, and everyone that works down there.
They're
very responsive.
Thank you, Councilor. We appreciate that.
I forgot Irene and Steve.
So. Yeah. I have more questions.
Especially Steve, you know, thoughts and prayers go out to your family. Councilor Bill Linehan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Commissioner Vindaka, and all of your team. You know, I've worked with each one of you for many, many years trying to improve the quality of life in our city. And I just, and I think that the Transportation Department is an exceptional department. It really is. It gets the job done. It generates revenue. It does all the things you could possibly want out of a department. It makes our city safer. It decreases the amount of pressure on people's quality of life every single day. And the expectations continue to rise, and which is a good thing, because we're held to a very high standard for our quality of life. And that's why Boston is so attractive and is growing at 10, 15,000 people a year over the past, you know, 5 years or so. But as my dear colleague from East Boston, I have much, much concern about the action of cutting the FTEs in enforcement. You all know that I'm looking to create another shift so that we can better enforce the regulations in some parts of my district, and also looking to expand that particular enforcement regimen. And that is absolutely impossible. So a couple quick questions on enforcement. I understand where the administration's going on this. I've been briefed on that, and I know that they're trying to have actual FTEs and not those that float. So what's the average FTE for enforcement over the past 5 years?
Councilor, we typically average about 165 officers. That's been the norm for quite a while, going back beyond even the 5 years. As Coleman Flaherty mentioned, we did have that one year where we increased the total number, and we absorbed a significant number of police cadets that were being laid off.
Right.
So we're right where we are normally right now. We actually hired a class that began last week of 14 new PEOs, and we've been engaged in a shift bidding process to reallocate and redeploy the officers to where we feel we need more coverage.
Right.
So right now, we feel very confident that with the new technology that we've introduced and with the staffing levels that we have, that we can adequately cover the neighborhoods the way we'd like.
With all due respect, 29 enforcement officers. If you said five, you know, and I'd say efficiencies, we're going to cover that and allow for the growth of enforcement, I'd say maybe. But when you're talking 29, impossible. From my experience, 30 some odd years in government, most of it on your side of the table. And so I have real concern with that, and I'm going to articulate that to the administration at all level. So when all of these efficiencies that you're talking about are basically going to be in the parking meter, right?
Yes.
How much of, what's the percentage of parking meter enforcement of all enforcement?
I don't have an exact percentage, but...
Is it 30%? You know, is it 2/3, 1/3, half of all? You know, I mean, because...
I would say it'd be roughly 1/3 to, you know, 40%.
So 35% of all the enforcement that goes on is related to parking meter, time-wise, time allocation. And again, it's general. I'm not holding you to it. Okay.
Roughly.
And that just seems like, again, your efficiencies are going to cover that.
Well, it's important to note, Counselor, that those 29 positions were long-term vacancies. We do still have 30 vacancies on the books. So we have positions that are available to us.
Right, but at some point you're supposed to be at capacity, and especially if you're not holding on to long-term vacancies as part of the administration's movement forward to be as accurate and genuine, as transparent as possible, right, which I agree with totally. But now you're talking this potentially 50 officers that could be out in the street generate, and I ask this question every year, an enforcement officer on the average, including all of their benefits, is about $50,000. And what do they generate a year on the average? How much is the, I'll do the math, 165 into whatever the total amount of revenue you generated from fines.
It's substantially
right.
More.
That's right. So listen, there's a whole bunch of FTEs in this entire building, in our entire organization, that need to be addressed. This is not one of them. This is absolutely not one of them. So get efficient, more technology, but 29 and fill the vacancies. I mean, because there's plenty of enforcement that needs to occur. And therefore, they generate revenue, which justifies the enforcement and more. Not that we're penalizing people to generate revenue, but at least it's one of those divisions that generates revenue along with ISD and some of the other EMS. You know, they generate money. And so I'm not expecting you to answer other than those questions. It's evident that, to me, that we need to do something about it. I understand you're expanding programs, all of these programs. I think they're terrific. But our core mission in transportation is safety and enforcement. Okay. Again, I like all of the programming, continue to do it.
Thank you, Councilor. And on behalf of the Transportation Department, we do appreciate your partnership and your advocacy. We are always available to respond to your constituents and to work with you on our transportation programs. We appreciate that.
And you always, the Transportation Department is extremely responsive. But this is an issue that I've been hopping on for a few years now, if not in my entire term, along with Sal, which together is like 19 years. And we're not making any headway. So sometimes you have to take a stand, and then people will listen. So I'm kind of like, we need a response. We need a response from the top telling us that these FTEs are justified, or that we just need more enforcement out here. Mm-hmm. To switch gears, most of the development, I'd say 45 to 60% of all the development that goes on in the city goes on in my district. And I have $3 to $4 billion in review, under review right now, either pre-BRA process, or that excludes the appetite of others that want to go down the line, and it excludes a construction that's underway at this time. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of people coming to work. That's a lot of folks going to live. And just in the Back Bay alone, we've this year heard about $1 billion development with the Back Bay Back Bay Station. There's major transportation issues in and around that. Trinity has not been built. That process has already been permitted. John Hancock is right down the street. So in a matter of a block and a half, you have all of that development. And that wasn't highlighted in the areas of concern. So this is, again, about, do you have enough people to do all the work? And I'm not putting you on the spot, Vineet, because I've sat in your seat. But we need more people to do transportation work, because we're building at a rate that can't sustain the infrastructure of our city. We can't get people in and out. Sooner or later, they're going to stop coming. You can put them on bikes. You can put them on buses. Right now, you get on the Red Line in Broadway, and I think the other half of the train is still in Andrew. That's how many people are using the T. So we need to resolve some of this. I don't think we can wait for 2030. We might be gridlocked by 2030. So that clearly is a long-term issue. So, and the parking meter fund, last one. I'm sorry, Mr. Chair. The parking meter fund?
Yes.
How much money's in it?
Well, at the end of the current fiscal year, FY16, this should be approximately $102 million. Of that, $27 million will be appropriated out through the city.
That's
leaving a balance of $91
million. $91 going into
For FY17, they will appropriate $37.5 million from that fund.
Good.
Which will leave a balance of $69 million.
But then how much did you get this year?
Well, this year it will be $27 million that's appropriated from the...
No, but how much revenue did you get this
year? Oh, I'm sorry. Revenues have been consistent around $16 million
$16 million
for the last few years.
Okay,
yes.
So you get it down to $70 million, and then we'll get another... So it'll be up to $86 million again by this time next year.
Okay.
That's a lot of money to be sitting on. Especially when it's transportation. You guys do an excellent job. You can use all the money you can get. I think every dollar you spend is spent so wisely. So I don't know why we're holding on to your money. And some of that money can go to DPW because they do highway stuff.
That's correct. And of that appropriation next year, I know $15 million is for the bridge that we previously mentioned.
Okay.
And another $6.5 million from that fund has been used to fund a couple of our capital projects this year, including... the replacement of the parking meters that was funded through here, and the BPOC project with the curbside regulation database.
Good. Those well, I'm glad that there's more money coming out of that fund.
The new administration has appropriated.
Yep, thank you.
Thank you. We've been joined by Councilor at Large Michael Flaherty. Chair recognizes Councilor Josh Zakem.
Thank you. Well, it's real loud. All right. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I was going to follow up on Councilor Linehan's comments on the parking meter fund. It just seems to me that there are needs, I mean, and work is being done. I mean, there's good work being done by your department, obviously, and in conjunction with Public Works. But is there, I mean, this isn't the stabilization fund for the city. Is there any I don't understand why we aren't putting more out there. I mean, there are needs across the city, transportation-wise, road-wise. I mean, is there whether it's a budgeting calculation, I mean, is there a justification for having $60, $70 million just sitting there?
I think that's a better question to ask of the central CFO's office, perhaps. But, you know, we make our requests when we submit our budget proposals. And, you know, they, like I said, they have funded these new projects.
And the requirement is it really just has to be transportation related. So obviously the parking meters make sense. But say, I mean, Audubon Circle is being redesigned. Would that qualify, you know, redesigning of an intersection, do those things qualify?
It's restrictive language, and I think on a case-by-case basis, it has to be examined through the legal department.
Well, I would just join with my colleagues, and it's something I'll certainly raise with the CFO also. We're talking about very tight budget times here. Money is fungible. I mean, if we can be funding, you know, the parking clerk $8.5 million out of here, that's $8.5 million we have for, you know, for police, for fire, for the schools, for, you know, the host of other issues. So I'm just a little baffled. I'm a, you know, former municipal finance lawyer, a bond lawyer. I obviously want to be prudent with our spending and keeping reserves, but that just seems like a very high amount. So
we will take that back to the budget office, Counselor. Over the last year, though, the budget office has been more open to utilizing that fund for various sources, including the parking meters that
it's definitely
Coleman
trending up. I mean, I
did, and the bridge. So yeah. We'll continue those conversations.
Thank you. And I was going to start off by saying, you know, how great it is to work with all of you. But no, Councilor Linehan started on the parking meter fund. So it has been a pleasure. I think there have been a lot of issues in my district that we've worked on very recently. I think on roadway redesigns, on community outreach and planning. And I keep hearing from residents that they are really impressed, and I'm impressed because I'm copied on a lot of these emails with the responses, the response time, the attention to detail from Charlotte Fleetwood and other folks who've been working on the planning, particularly along Mass Ave and on Beacon Street where we had the traffic incidents. So I want to commend you for that. I also want to thank Greg and his department for, you know, obviously I think the enforcement around Fenway has been a resounding success. I hear over and over again from folks, you know, how much it's improved their situation and finding parking, and it sounds like it's changing behavior, which is very important. I have a couple questions, though, or just points I want to make on the Mass Ave redesign right now that's been going on as part of Vision Zero. It's certainly hearing from folks with some concerns about losing, obviously, loading zones and valet for a lot of the businesses along there, particularly the Elliott Hotel, some of the restaurants. I just wanted to confirm for them that there is an ongoing discussion and that those things are being considered, because I think obviously we have to work with in physical space we have, and we're not going to get a perfect design, but I do think especially loading, if we're going to have trucks double parked, I don't know if that's going to be much safer. So I don't know if there's anything you can comment on now or just...
Councilor, I am in receipt of some of those comments from the businesses affected, and we will be reaching out to them this week and involving them in the process. We did some initial outreach. Folks went door to door, and that sparked some conversation, and we're committed to continuing that with everyone affected in that corridor.
Great. Thank you. I guess going back to enforcement in general, there is a lot, I think, particularly in some of our streets downtown, you know, a lot of the neighborhoods I represent, obviously it's congested, people can't find things. What are our options on trucks? I don't mean just FedEx and UPS. I know they, you know, a lot of their tickets fund a lot of what we do here, it seems like. But other trucks, moving vehicles, when they're double parked, I mean, what is the general procedure? I mean, are enforcement officers generally writing tickets? Are people just taking the tickets and saying, you know, forget it, we'll just sit here? I mean, is there a procedure for towing, particularly, I think, a lot larger trucks? I know we have a contract with a third-party vendor. Is there anything on that, or are there sort of hot spots that are being identified, or just sort of as calls come in or as officers see that? Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, as you mentioned, a lot of companies, they take the ticket as basically part of doing business, so they're not, I guess, afraid to be fined. We do contract with Tedesco Towing to tow large vehicles, and they're very responsive.
Mm.
You know, the officers, when they need to, they call it in, or the tech center, traffic management center, will identify an area where there's a problem. They'll call enforcement, and we'll send either a tow supervisor or an officer to tag and get the truck dispatched.
Mm. Right.
So we try to stay on top of it, and I think we've been fairly successful in the past at changing some behavior. We've also met with some vendors, for example, Harpoon Brewery and Burke Distributors. We've trained their employees on where they can park and basically how they can avoid becoming a problem in the neighborhood or on the street. Mm. So we're open to doing that with any business that wants to use our resources.
Thank you. And it's been a great change on Gloucester Street. I know we talked about that the last year or so, and definitely improved behavior over there. So thank you for the responsiveness. I just asked the questions. I know on a case by case, your department has been incredibly responsive, but it does seem like, you know, as we go in, you know, just the cost of doing business, but it's not just an inconvenience issue, but obviously public safety, if folks can't, you know, whether it's police, fire, EMS, getting around. So I do want to just keep that on the agenda, and it sounds like it is.
Yes.
And then before I get the hook from the chairman here, the West End transportation planning study, I don't know what the proper title is. Can you speak to that at all, Commissioner Vineet?
Sure. That's the we call it the North Station Transportation Action Plan. As you know, the project is being managed contractually through the BRA, but there's a very close-knitted team of both BRA and BTD planners. We have selected a vendor after the selection process, so we are kind of going through all the legal issues before we announce that, and I can see us starting very soon. Through a pretty extensive community process.
Great.
And thank you for your support in making that initiative commence.
Thank you.
Councilor, we're committed to this process actually producing action items, so it won't be a long planning effort.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that. I know the folks who live down here and the many more who are moving down there and all these new developments that are in my district, Councilor LaMattina's district, Councilor Linehan's district, really will appreciate that. I will conclude. I see the chairman, but just one, I would just reiterate, I think you on a financial basis are probably the most efficient or one of the most efficient departments we have. So I join with my previous colleagues and just encouraging you to be more aggressive, asking for money from the parking meter fund and for funding the FTEs, the enforcement officers. I think it not only contributes to the quality of life in the city, but to our finances as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor.
Thank you. Councilor Nisa Sabi-George.
Thank you so much, Chair. And thank you, Commissioner, and everyone for being here today. I have a few questions. I'd like to start with TAPAs, the Transportation Access Plan Agreements. Can you explain or sort of explain what that is, walk us through that process? And I'm curious as to why the number with development booming now, why that number has gone down over the last few years for projected TAPAs going forward.
Sure, I'm happy to address that. So transportation access plan agreements are signed with every new development that's over 50,000 square feet, which goes through a development review process with the BRA. Through that process, we are able to do an extensive review of the development. And through that process, we are able to identify specific mitigation measures that the developer has to fund. Those might be improvements that we require before the development actually starts construction to manage traffic in the area. It includes improvements that are constructed while the project is itself under construction. And it includes measures that the developer is required in terms of transportation demand management, you know, encourage more people to take public transportation or take bicycling as an option to get to where they have to go. The number of access plan agreements that we sign is directly correlated to the applications that we receive. And typically that process starts a year and a half, 2 years in advance of the project actually getting constructed. So many of the numbers that you're seeing from last year and the years before that reflect the development that we're seeing today. So we're kind of in advance of construction happening. So which is why we're, as we, you know, the number of proposals that are coming in are generally constant, but have decreased just a little bit. Is that helpful?
Yep, thank you so much. The Barr Foundation had funded two full-time positions that are wrapping up during fiscal year 17. Is there any plan, specifically as it relates to the Boston Mobility Action Plan, is there any plans to retain those positions or to continue that work going forward?
Constable, there's one position that's funded through the Barr Foundation, which is the project manager for our Go Boston 2030, our citywide mobility plan. And that position is specific to that particular project from the Barr Foundation. And we're expecting to finish that in early fall. And so the position would not be continued once the Barr Foundation funding is finished.
Would there be any sort of continued work, though, associated with that plan going forward? And will we make sure that that work is able to continue?
Absolutely. The recommendations, some of them are short-term recommendations that we want to implement in the next few years, and some of them may be longer-term recommendations. Those are recommendations that are informing many of the department's overall activities, whether it's Vision Zero, or whether it's working with the MBTA, or whether it's looking at development review. So it's a broader plan that's informing many of our activities.
Very good. And then my last question for this round, anyway, is regarding some of the revenue with Zipcar parking spaces. Do we have, how much money have we received so far? What's our plan going forward with that revenue, projected revenue, all of that?
I don't have the total revenue numbers with me, but I'd be happy to get them. The concept is that the vendors pay a licensing fee to the city, which goes to the general fund. So it's general fund revenue.
Okay. None of it goes to BTD.
Correct.
Directly.
No, they pay a licensing fee for downtown spaces and a separate fee for spaces outside of the downtown core.
Generally successful, mixed reviews. What's the response been?
It's generally been successful. We've gotten some metrics back from both Zipcar and Enterprise, and it appears that the access to those spaces is having a positive effect.
Right, thank you. I'd love that those dollar amounts. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Chair.
Thank you. Councilor Campbell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you guys for being here. And I have to thank your department tremendously. I was just sworn in January and already have had folks from BTD, Charlotte, Stephanie, Vision Zero go out into certain parts of District 4 and do some really incredible walkthroughs with the residents there who greatly appreciate it, including get them new signs, so different things. So I just want to start by saying thank you for your responsiveness. I just have a few questions. One is, so I attended the hearing on the transit signal priority and was surprised to hear that this technology could be used at certain intersections because BTD has actually connected some more intersections to your central mainframe system. Just curious if BTD is going to follow up with the T about pushing for those intersections to be a part of the transit signal priority. And if so, how else we could be helpful as a council to get more streets connected to that technology?
Yes, Councilor, we are actively following up with the T to ensure that as we plan out our signalization upgrades, that we are in communication with the T and connect them as we can to our traffic management center.
Well, I will say thank you for that. It was a very informative hearing and clearly showed BTD is on it. The T, obviously, I think needs to step up a little bit, but thank you for that.
Thank you.
I got a lot of calls from District 4 residents about the Charlestown pilot program, so increasing the fee from $40 to $90. How do residents in a particular section, this is actually in Mattapan, southern part of Dorchester, some residents in a residential neighborhood who are interested in doing something like that, how would they go about doing that?
They can certainly reach out to Kevin Donahue in my office, and we will work with the ONS coordinator to have these conversations in the community with our Public Works Department.
Thank you. I have, three more questions. One is, Bowdoin Geneva is slated to have a transportation study done, which, thank you, I'm very excited for that. Just curious in general terms what that would entail and what that would look like.
We will work hand-in-hand with the community, identify what issues the community in general feels need to be addressed. Our approach is to have a comprehensive look. So it's about pedestrian safety first, and then making sure that other issues such as parking, traffic flow, the use of bicycles are also addressed. That area is also heavily served by the MBTA's buses. So we want to make sure that are the stops in the right places? Do they need to be moved around? Do we need more stops? Can bus service be made more efficient? And we'll make sure to keep the T engaged in the process.
Well, definitely keep me posted. This is very exciting. I know residents in that community, and I'm sure Councillor Baker is happy as well, has been looking for a long time for something to be done, particularly at that intersection, which is very large. Two more. One is the new hub hoist expansions. Do we currently have any in Mattapan? And if not, is that sort of a part of any conversation to get Mattapan included in this?
To the best of my knowledge, we do not have any in Mattapan right now. And we are, as the commissioner mentioned, we are expanding out into North Dorchester.
Which is great. I'm seeing them all the time.
And Roxbury. And that is the first step, or actually is one of several steps that we are taking to continue to expand the hubway program in neighborhoods to the further to the south. The way the hubway system works is that each station has to be within a certain distance of the next one. So it expands as a network.
Okay.
We can't put stations in isolation in different neighborhoods because then it's just not convenient for those who want to use the system to exchange bicycles or go from point A to point B and then leave a bicycle there. So we're over the years we're going to slowly expand through the entire city.
No, that's helpful, and I'm only bringing that up because Boston Bikes, which is incredible, did a clinic in Mattapan this weekend. It was very exciting. Had a lot of residents, including seniors who had never been on bikes before, out there riding and learning how to ride. And that came up as the interest grows for residents in Mattapan to begin to cycle and use bikes. That's a natural question, is when do we get hubway? So this is good to know.
Thank you.
My last question has to do with, obviously, Vision Zero, neighborhood slow streets. Everyone wants to see Vision Zero, that the sort of goals of Vision Zero actualize. Outside of housing, the second biggest issue is transportation. It's probably on par with housing. We track our constituent requests. And folks complaining about, you know, there was just an accident on my street or someone was speeding up and down my street. So in addition to signs and enforcement, which is important, they want to see infrastructure changes. Speed bumps, speed humps, we hear about it almost every single day. So in talking about or hearing about the parking fund, now that we're not saying no to speed bumps, could we have a conversation about using some of the funding in that pool of money for a speed bump or speed hump program in certain neighborhoods? I know some communities have been asking for speed bumps for over five years. So there are already, I think, streets that are identified that could use speed bumps as an effective tool. I'm just curious if the parking fund, money from that $69 million, could be used for something like that.
We are exploring options to utilize the meter fund and continuing those conversations with the CFO's office. We will certainly aggregate all of the comments here and take them back to in our conversations with the CFO and our budget director?
I will say, I imagine, you know, in order to put in a speed bump, you have to go out and assess if that's the right place to do it. But the city would win big if they started looking at particular streets and putting in speed humps or speed bumps in certain neighborhoods on certain streets that could use it. I know where I live. I'm near EMS, so it's hard because they use our streets to cut through. You can't put them there. But in other neighborhoods, I imagine you can. And those, for me, are quick fixes for some of the concerns that we get for folks who are excited about Councilor Baker's speed reduction ordinance. But at the end of the day, people don't necessarily pay attention to signs. They're speeding. Speed humps or speed bumps go a long way. So I would encourage you guys, and hopefully the city, to encourage you guys to use that fund, particularly for a project like that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Councilor Presley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Checking the clock. It's good afternoon. Good afternoon to all of you, and thank you for your commitment daily and for your partnership. So I wanted to just focus the balance of my question. A number of my questions have already been asked and answered, but relative to, and I did step out, so hopefully you're not having to repeat too much, so I apologize in advance. But I think I've done maybe three hearings in the chamber specific to reducing and hopefully eliminating motor vehicle and cyclist collisions. And the first two hearings were focused specifically on pushing for the crash data report. And that has since been released and provided. And, you know, just in wanting to make sure that all of our strategic planning and our goals for Vision Zero, that continues to be a process that is informed by community. And this is really about all of our sharing the roadways, no bias towards pedestrians or motor vehicle drivers or cyclists. That being said, wanting to make sure that at all times that we are actively hearing the input from the cycling community about those parts in the city that are more vulnerable and that are hot spots. Where the fatalities have occurred in the city, these are places in the city that within the cycling community, you know, they know are especially dangerous. So I'm just, you know, curious as to how much of the data from that crash data report is informing where the investments are being made.
We do have representatives from the Boston Cyclists Union that are part of the Vision Zero Task Force. So as we take a look at that data combined with the safety concerns map, EMS data, BPD data, all of that is working together to inform our priority locations.
Okay, so there is an overlay. I know they're at the table, but okay.
Yes.
All right. You know, we have to hold ourselves accountable. Oftentimes we produce reports and, you know, the feedback is not actually integrated into anything. So, but I'm glad to hear that that's happening, and I thank you for that.
Thank you.
And that community input process continues not just around that table, but in meetings throughout the city, correct?
Correct.
And then how is that data being synthesized and considered to be integrated?
Part of the task force recommendations, some of them are out there already that are available on our website. And some of our other areas are priority locations, like the Talbot-Norfolk Triangle, where we're able to make real safety improvements, reducing speed limits, improving crosswalks. And when we find that when we implement some of those solutions, it makes it safer for everyone. So the data is being used to inform not only our rapid response team, but also longer term objectives of the Vision Zero Task Force.
Okay. And so again, on the community input and engagement front, in terms of the 311 and the app and people, you know, taking pictures and sort of sending that back for this is where there needs to be an improvement or a cycle track. What happens with that? And what should I tell constituents who have not found that they've received the responsiveness they were hoping?
Just to add to what the commissioner was saying, so on the one hand, we take data from police and EMS. On the other hand, we have a rich trove of data coming from the community through the community concerns map that's online. We've literally got thousands and thousands of comments on that map, which is community input. So based on those two kind of general data sources, we prioritize where our investment towards improving safety for everyone.
So in terms of where I should be directing constituents,
they should go to
should continue to go to the website, and should they continue to post pictures?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
All right, great. Again, also just sitting in that constituent space, you know, I've heard constituents that there's limited funding for the installation of new bike racks and that the funding is really to repair existing racks. Is there any merit to that?
Bike racks?
We do want to replace existing bike racks, but we are open to installing bike racks in new locations. So please have your constituents send us where they'd like to see them located.
Okay. Another issue, since I work very closely, and I know you do with our small businesses, and I work very closely with our restaurateurs, and just wanted to just plant a seed for consideration that, you know, they support, by and large, the restaurateurs I've spoken to, these investments. I think it makes it easier for people even to, you know, patronize the restaurant as we move towards greater development density. And they'll need to be putting up some, they need those racks, you know.
Sure.
But just wanted, they are impacted with cycle tracks and lanes when it comes to trucks doing deliveries, valet parking. So I just want to make sure that that's a part of the conversation as well.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, Counselor. And if there are specific establishments that would like bike racks, please, you know, send them directly to Kevin Donahue, and he'll make sure that they get to Boston Bikes and we prioritize it.
Okay. So I did want to just ask about the $3.1 million figure for Vision Zero, and it is up $200,000. I mean, I think we've got a very ambitious plan and we're behind. So I appreciate the increase, but, you know, not sure that it's really comparable to what we need to get to where we're trying to go by the benchmarks that we've set. So I wanted to know how we are. You know, Boston, we're very competitive. If this monetary investment is comparable in keeping us competitive with other cities?
Yes, it is. It's one clarification. It's $3 million for FY17, but it's $3 million in addition every, you know, for the next three fiscal years as well. So we're looking at a total of $9 million plus of that's going towards Vision Zero and neighborhood slow streets. And that number compares to what San Francisco has, what Chicago has. So it's a significant commitment from the city of Boston towards Vision Zero.
I'm sorry, what were the cities you named? Chicago and?
And San Francisco.
Okay,
yeah.
All right. All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Council Baker.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning, Gina and your team. Thanks for coming out today. Gina, can you give us timeline for the pilots for, I think it's Geneva and all the other Vision Zero pilots? When will we expect to see all that stuff?
So there are two neighborhood slow streets or traffic calming programs,
yep.
One in Stony Brook neighborhood and the other in the Talbot Norfolk Triangle.
Okay.
Our goal is to make improvements this year for both those districts. There is the Massachusetts Avenue Vision Zero Priority area, and that too we are poised to make investments in.
We are
on
Mass Ave.
This is
Beacon.
There are three phases to it. So the section that goes from the Charles River in the Back Bay area, and then from the Back Bay area up to Millenia Cass.
Okay.
That would be implemented this year. We're going to start the design process for the section that goes from Millenia Cass further past 1010 Mass Ave and into Dorchester.
So we're going to be able to design and implement this year?
The first two phases, yes.
Okay. And the other two areas that you spoke about, design this year or design and implement?
Design and implement this year.
Okay, good. And will that come out of, I know we talked about the meter fund. Will that come out of the meter fund? No.
No, that's capital.
No,
that'll be capital.
Funds for that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And we talked about FTEs also quite a bit, so I won't bring those up too much. But I do want to the $37 million for coming out of the meter fund, where is that going to be spent? That's probably for you, Coleman.
Hold on one second. Let me just
a portion of that will be spent on the Northern Ave Bridge.
Correct.
Allocated for the Northern Ave Bridge. And there will be a separate allocation for BTD meter operation.
Okay, and that's the whole $37 million?
Combined.
When you say the Northern Ave Bridge,
design implement totally done out of that $37 million?
No, I believe that's a portion of the funds necessary.
Okay.
There'll be additional funding in FY18 for that bridge.
For
as
that
well.
Bridge, okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Thought that was a good number for the bridge. We could maybe buy two at that price.
That would be a good price.
Yeah, because there's another bridge that we need to talk about. When can we expect, after we do these pilots with the Vision Zero, the calming measures, when can we expect to be able to implement some of that stuff in the neighborhoods that aren't such large whole areas, like smaller streets or just one street or one smaller neighborhood? Do we really have an appetite for these things in the neighborhoods, or like when can we start to expect some changes there?
We definitely have an appetite. We are keen to move forward with programs in addition to the ones that I mentioned.
Yeah.
And so at this point, we want to identify what we'd like to do in calendar year 17 and calendar year 18. And we are in the process of setting up an application process.
Okay.
So that neighborhood groups have a well laid out, transparent, action oriented process that they can follow up on.
Okay. So 17, 18 calendar year, we should expect to see some changes.
Absolutely.
Excellent.
In districts that are in addition to the ones that I talked about.
Yeah. There. Yeah. Yeah. The cameras that we talk about that are traffic cameras, is there any discussion with the police about interfacing those so they become brick cameras also? Has there been any discussion? Because you have incidents that happen and people look at the cameras that are on the traffic, and we only keep that data is real-time data. It's not stored, if I'm correct.
BPD does, in fact, have access to our cameras. So
they do?
Yes, they do, sir.
And how long is your data on your camera stored?
We store the data for a short period of time, but it is available to the police department.
So if something happens and they're coming back looking in a month, they could already be gone?
They may have access to it.
So when you say access, they need to come to you for access, or does it go right to
them? It's directly transmitted to them, so they are the repository of that data.
Interesting. Okay. We go look at the contracts a little bit. It says the MBTA gets $204,000. What do we have a contract with the MBTA for?
The MBTA is under contract for coin counting with us from when we removed the quarters from the parking meters. They come to the facility down on Frontage Road. We've already done some estimating. They take them. They deposit them. With armed security.
Okay.
So that's the contract.
Okay, thank you. And also you have $6 million for Xerox. Is that all your tickets?
Correct.
Just tickets?
Ticket processing, notifications, mailings, the data, all of that, reporting.
Xerox is a full service contract for the parking violation system. They also provide the ticket information management system that the enforcement officers utilize, as well as the seizure identification system, license plate recognition, registered motor vehicles, name and address acquisition, web-based payments. So it's an extensive contract that supports most of our enforcement efforts.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Councilor Jackson.
Excuse me. And I want to thank Commissioner Fandaka. Very responsive department, and I really appreciate your work. I do want to agree with and underscore what Council LaMartina and Council Linehan noted. I think it is a poor practice to not fully stock the enforcement officers. I think we're leaving money on the table. And I think in these difficult economic times, those dollars can definitely flow back. And very few people in this building collect their salary in terms of what they do relative to their job. And I just really think considering the additional places that are now resident parking and all of those places, we have a lot of room there to actually have a great deal more enforcement. And again, this is a place that it's uncomfortable. People don't like it. But it is something that living in a city, we realize that folks do get tickets. And I really do think that there's a lot of opportunity left on the table and a great deal of revenue left on the table here. And I think you could probably go up another 100 officers and still not get to the level of enforcement. As we hear, 15,000 people moving into the city each year. And so there's just more out there for that to occur. So I guess what can the parking meter fund be used for? Could we one-to-one fund your whole budget with it?
It can be used for BTD operations, but I believe they have to be specific to the meter shop and other operations.
And how much revenue does the meter shop bring in, and then how much does it cost us?
Oh, the meter revenues will be approximately $16 million for FY17, the same as for this year.
Yeah.
What it costs to run meters and operations, I have to break that down a little bit for you. I'll be happy to get that.
Okay. Does it cost more than $16 million approximately?
Approximately, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if that were the case, we have enough in that side to actually pay for the whole operations, which you're saying are more than the revenues that are actually brought in. I just bring that up. Over the course of the next couple of years, I'm chair of education. We're down about $32 million in the education space, and so really looking for places to be able to make that up. And it sounds like this is literally an accounting exercise. And that no one other than the people that we're talking about's jobs would actually be hindered here if there was a change in the spreadsheet. So, and that's not, again, I realize that's not your shop, but I just want to understand how that works. I guess the other areas that are pain points for me and the people that I serve, interestingly now, people now drive through Blue Hill Avenue instead of going around on the highway, which is a compliment to the city and public safety and all of those other things. But what it means is that it is a parking lot up Blue Hill Ave and up Warren Street. And so I guess that corridor, as well as what happens in Dudley Square, which again was probably set up for horse and carriage the above ground trains that used to run in that area. So I guess from a holistic perspective, considering now we know it's the physical center of the city of Boston, now there's a traffic gravitational pull towards that. What are the plans that we have to begin to deal with that? I know there's some timing and signaling timing that needs to be worked out, but where are we at relative?
Sure, I can talk about Dudley Square first. And Councilor, as you know, we've got at least a couple of projects that we're doing. There's a complete redesign of Dudley Street, including its extension onto Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. That includes putting new signals as part of a larger coordinated signal system for Dudley Square, because all the signals have to talk to each other to kind of make sure that traffic is moving quickly. Mm-hmm. We also are working with the MBTA, to figure out exactly what's the most efficient way for buses that are coming into the Dudley Square station.
Yes.
So those processes are ongoing, and they will inform the recently launched BRA's plan process as well. Mm. On Blue Hill Avenue, on Warren and Blue Hill Avenue, we are installing, and I'll get you the details on this, but there's a contract. We might have already done this, but to look at signals in that corridor and coordinate them.
Okay.
So there's on Blue Hill Warren, there's a concentrated effort to improve traffic flow.
Yeah, no, that's a personal pain point, because that's literally where I live, and I just see, and it's just so much coming together, and it might have made sense with less people, but now it definitely is a congestion point. I guess the piece around the 10% bike mode share by 2020, where are we relative to that component, and how does that tie into our goals with Vision Zero?
Just I'm not sure where that number came from, but the number that we use is 8% by 2030.
Okay.
That's the because it's relevant to what mode share changes might happen with other modes as well. Mm-hmm. More people in public transport, more people walking.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sorry, what is the second question?
How does it tie into Vision Zero?
Yeah, so bicycle use will increase if people feel safer on our streets. And Vision Zero provides that opportunity. We want to make it stress-free for Bostonians to ride a bicycle. We are also exploring, in many instances, throughout the city's neighborhoods, protected bicycle lanes, mm-hmm. where there's space to install them. So that's a program that's ongoing. We can give you more detailed briefings. But but basically, a Vision Zero would make it safer, would make it not only safer for those who are on bicycles, but those who want to bike would feel safer if they knew that all these improvements were being made.
Okay. And we recently went on a trip to look at bus rapid transit. I know it's a issue at a state level, but also is, I think, the part that we figured out last time when the stimulus package was around, was that if we don't deal with conversations at the local level, that some of those federal as well as state dollars won't actually flow. So I guess the question I had is, where are we at relative to kind of moving some of those conversations? And for the folks who are watching, bus rapid transit as an alternative to additional trains or other modes of transit. We got to see what it looked like in a very congested city in Mexico City. There's 20 million people there, and you're literally driving next to things that are 600, 1,000 years old. So we can't say that the city of Boston is that old and really congested spaces, but they move 6 million people a day in and around. And then there was the second question, and it'll be my last question, is what are the public-private partnerships that we are actually kind of looking at? Because what we saw there was a public-private partnership that actually helped industry and was sustainable because of how industry worked with the transportation municipality side.
Yeah, sure. We're working with the MBTA, and their transportation planning folks have identified key corridors which need bus rapid transit evaluation and mm-hmm. implementation if it's possible. And the way they've done that is that they've counted the number of people that are on that particular corridor. So, and then you see if you're counting the number of people, what percentage are in buses? And so you might find some corridors where the number of vehicles may be large, but the people in buses may be even larger. So based on that, they've identified some corridors, and we are working with them to see if we can provide any help to make buses move more efficiently.
Because I think there's an equity lens there that we should look at. And then the other piece is that we are making great assumptions about transit-oriented development. And if there's not transit, we can pretend that people who buy $1 million, $2 million houses are not going to have a car. But if they have to stand next to eight of me's around them in the T, all bundled up, that's going to be a huge issue relative to people really wanting. And so it would then not really be transit oriented development, because people would actually have to have a car or something to get themselves around.
Through Go Boston 2030, Councilor, we've heard from thousands of people. And one of the number one themes that's emerged is that folks want access to robust, reliable, and affordable transit systems.
Mm-hmm.
And I was on that Mexico trip And certainly, we've engaged the MBTA in those conversations to identify key corridors that we need to take a good look at.
Yeah. And the thing I would just simply say about that trip, it was amazing to see the ease of access and getting on and off of the bus, which the bus was actually literally like the train at the same level. You actually were able to roll on and roll off, even if you were handicapped or had a stroller. And another component of it was there was actually a section for men and a section for women, which actually, from a cultural perspective, worked actually really, really well. So I thought it was a really interesting piece. Thank you for your work. I would just lastly say, again, I absolutely agree with Councilor La Martina that we are missing out on a great deal of revenue. You have an opportunity to put 60, 70, 100 more enforcement officers out there. They'll pay for themselves, and then on top of that, bring us way more revenue. And I think that revenue is needed in these difficult economic times. In addition, I would also, speaking directly to the administration, say, and I'll say it here and I'll say it directly to them, is that that's an accounting, there's some stuff that can happen on an Excel spreadsheet that wouldn't put any hitch in your giddy up, and you would actually have an opportunity to continue to do your work and to move out the money from the parking meter fund. Thank you so much, Mr. Chair. Appreciate
thank
it.
You. Thank you. Councilor Flaherty.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Gina and her team, specifically Gina, obviously Greg, Kevin Donahue, and Steve Pascantilli, who are truly nights, holidays, and weekends. Anytime me or my staff has reached out, there's been a prompt and appropriate response on a very pressing transportation or, in some instances, a public safety matter. So kudos to you, Gina, and to your team that continues to provide great results for our city. I want to take this opportunity also to advocate for full funding. I know you'll hear from Rosemary Jones today at some point for the long-delayed landscape plan between Center and South over at Hyde Square and Forest Hill. So I know that the total cost of that is somewhere in excess of $850. And I know on the line items on page 320, there's an appropriation for $400. So I just want to make sure that the folks over there that have been advocating for this for a significant period of time, we can finally make that a reality. So wanted to opine on that. Wanted to also talk to you a little bit about the handicap parking fraud and abuse. I know that we've talked about the handicap meter. I mean, the meter fund, we lose out on millions of dollars because of the fraud and abuse that exists with respect to those that take advantage or at least perpetrate a fraud and take that very precious and valuable spot off the street for someone who really needs it, that has a legitimate handicap. At the same time, they don't give us the revenue now because we have the parking apps, which I do get calls that it doesn't accept American Express and it doesn't accept the city's credit union card. I don't know if that's something that could be done internally to include both American Express and the credit union debit card, but I do get some calls on that people that want to, and believe me, your meter maids do a phenomenal job. I'm the recipient of some of those orange reminders, but nonetheless, they're out there morning, noon, and night in inclement weather conditions, so that's a disclosure there. But I think we can and should be doing a better job around meters in terms of increasing our meter capacity, but also to really crack down on the fraud and the abuse around handicap parking. And now that we have the app, all folks who take who use the meter should be paying the meter and should be treated equally in paying the meter. And once that happens, I think we can reduce the fraud and the abuse by 80, maybe 90%. So if we can just get your thoughts and an update maybe on the handicap parking fraud and abuse.
Sure. Thank you, Councilor, and thank you for your strong advocacy for reforms related to handicap parking abuse. With regard to the payment app, we do not take American Express. The City of Boston does not take that as a payment option at this time. But we will certainly get back an answer to you on the credit union card. It should be able to take any MasterCard or Visa through the payment app as well as at any of our on-street metered spaces. With regard to handicap parking abuse, we working with Councilor La Martina to do an audit of neighborhood handicapped parking spaces. in East Boston. The state, through the RMV and the Inspector General, has a handicap parking abuse task force that Greg Rooney sits on, along with Steve McGuire, who is our parking clerk. They have a number of recommendations that have been put forth as a result of an investigation that the Inspector General conducted. I'll turn it over to Greg Rooney, and he can speak a little bit more with regard to the workings of that task force, as well as the approach for the Enforcement Division with regard to handicap placard abuse.
That'd be great. Thank you, Greg, if I can get an update. And I'm assuming that around the dexterity issue, and the reason that the fraud and abuse exists is because if you have a handicap placard, you don't have to pay the meter. So you take up a very precious spot in the downtown, and you can stay there for 6 hours, 8 hours, 10 hours, as long as you want. And so therein lies the issue. And it was really designed so that folks that had dexterity issues and were unable to pay the meter, they couldn't pay the meter. So that's the catch there. That's why all the folks from the suburban communities, north, south, and west, come into the downtown, park in front of their office, put the placard up, walk away from the vehicle with their gym bag, carrying boxes with no medical device, no oxygen tank. They're clearly visibly able to walk without impediments, and yet it's the biggest scam going, and we lose out on millions of dollars. So hopefully the Inspector General and the Attorney General, the RMV, realize that just by requiring people to pay the meter now because we have this technology, that in and of itself will solve the problem. That won't solve Councilor Lamantina's neighborhood problem, which I concur with that neighborhood problem. Again, everyone just gets the placard because they think it's an excuse to get a parking spot in front of your house. And again, all able-bodied people that are in, can run the gamut, bowling leagues, dancing, fitness animals, if you will, but yet somehow they get that ailment because they want the spot in front of their house. So that aside, the downtown, the business district area is where it's prevalent and where we lose out on precious revenue. And so if I can just get your 2 cents on this, it'd be great.
Sure. So some of the initiatives that have already begun within the RMV is to redesign the placards themselves, to change the process and the renewal process so that placards aren't basically given out indefinitely. You know, we're looking to make it a little more difficult for people to, you know, hold on to a placard, pass it around to a family member if, you know, God forbid, the placard owner passes away. So the RMV is taking steps to improve those processes. There's also a conversation about eliminating the unlimited time at the meters, the non-payment of meters.
Right.
You know, those are some things that would take some, legislative acts, but they're definitely on the table. And they'll be in some of the other communities that are sitting at the table, they'll be doing some enforcement, basically a sting, if you will, in certain areas. So unfortunately for BTD, our officers don't have the authority to write a ticket for the misuse of placard. Right. We can only write a violation for the parking meter. So what we do is if an officer sees somebody who, whether the placard looks like it's been defaced, if it's expired, we will write the ticket. We will also notify the registry and in some cases even reach out to the placard owner directly to find out whether or not they're aware that their placard's expired or whether it's being used. So we try to work with the RMV very closely, and we'll continue to do so. And Commissioner McCosh is also on that task force as well, and she's been a strong advocate in order to, strengthen some of the rules.
Gotcha. I mean, we're always going to have the situation where you're going to have that doctor that's going to just prescribe the oxys and the perks and tell you that you're handicapped when you're really not. So we're really not going to get to the root of this problem until we require all those that are using the spaces to have to pay like everybody else and to be treated like everyone else. And once you do that, 90% of the fraud and the abuse will disappear. And so hopefully the RMV and the Inspector General, that they understand that that's the crux. It's less about how the placard's designed, but the reform is clearly needed. But you're always just going to have that doctor, if you will, that's just going to, I want to say, I think it's there's one doctor, I think, that's responsible for probably like 90% of the placards in East Boston. that's always going to happen, despite whether we change the policy, but just be requiring everyone, given that we have the technology, we have the apps, there's no reason why people could not pay the meter. I think that would go a long way. I'm prepared to file something tomorrow.
Is that?
Once we have the green light.
Is that state law?
Through the chair.
Right. It's a state law.
Right.
Yes, Councillor, it is.
So the city cannot require you to pay the meter currently the way it's configured.
That is correct, Councillor.
Unless there's a change. So then we would need state legislation, so then we should be working with our counterparts then at the legislature. Mm. But is there movement afoot on that front, or is everyone just talking about it? While we continue to talk about it, we lose out on millions of dollars of very precious revenue that could be going to its very important and vital programs.
It is a recommendation that came out of the Inspector General's report.
Okay. And so when you see, like, an example is when Government Center Garage, when that gets redeveloped, that's literally going to be 1,000 people that are going to be without a parking spot, and you're going to see a significant number of them will then all of a sudden go to Dr. Hook Me Up, and they'll have a placard, and that'll be less spaces in the downtown, less people paying meters, less revenue. It's just how it works. I'm just giving it to you straight. It's the biggest scam going. Everybody knows it. Folks that are living in the suburban communities, it's a free pass to come into the downtown, to not have to take public transportation, to not have to carpool, and to literally park in front of their downtown office space for the entire day, no quarter in the meter, no revenue for the city, and they don't have a legitimate issue. And again, this is an anti-handicap, this is an anti-veteran, this is about trying to make sure that the spaces are there and available for the people that need them the most. So I'm going to continue to be dogged on that. I'll work with Councilor Lamantina for the district piece of it, but I think the biggest impact is in the downtown, where we're losing out on that revenue. And just shifting to a hot spot, there's a shuttle bus trolley spot that's over on Dorchester Ave between, say, Congress and Summer Street. And I see it all the time. I see young kids crossing the very busy Congress Street to go over towards the milk bottle and to do the tea party and to do the museum. There's a better location that's actually down on Congress Street in front of the museum. So that's trolley and bus stop is specifically there as a drop-off place for folks that are going to the tea party, to the museum, and to the milk bottle. They should relocate that over there. And the good news is that spots could now open up to be metered spots for the local businesses there. There's a Bo Loco. I think there's an ice cream shop. There's Smith & Walensky's. There's a Papagayo. So I think they'd be excited to get those three or four spots back. So I don't know who we need to talk to get back out there to look at that one. And then maybe this is to Vineet, clearly the New Balance bike share, adding spots. I know my office has worked with your staff to identify some private partners. I'm all for putting additional bike racks out there. I just don't want it at the expense of very precious parking spots and revenue-generating meters. And leaning on private partners like we were able to do for you guys with Bank of America and with Beth Israel Hospital to get those kiosk in appropriate locations that are out of the path of traffic and don't interrupt with commerce and revenue-generating meters. One of the issues you have is that the company that makes them, they don't make them in sort of fours and sixes and eights. You either get the standard version or you get the super deluxe version. We need to put some pressure on this company to be creative around these bike racks, because I think my colleague, Councilor Presley, was referencing the need for more, and there's an excitement around getting more. But people will have them in front of their business if they are, say, fours and sixes, but they don't want the 17 and the, what are they, 17 and 30?
Eight or 16, from what I understand.
16?
Yeah, eight. I think it's a dozen. It's eight to a dozen.
Yeah, so someone will be like, hey, I'll take a small one for four or for six. If we can do that, I think we would do that all day long. The problem they have is they only make them in two sizes, big and bigger, you know? And so if they could customize that device, and again, I think initially they wanted them to be big because they were in the game for the first time and they wanted to make sure they're going to make repairs. They kind of wanted to consolidate. But now that there's so many more locations, having them design a smaller kiosk model, I think would go a long way in allowing us to expand the program, but to do it that's sort of more palatable for small local businesses or for residential or condo associations. So if you can maybe keep an eye on that and push back a little bit and see if they can come up with some fours and sixes.
Okay, we'll definitely ask them.
I think that would go a long way. And I think that's it.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time and attention. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Do you have any language that governs the parking meter fund?
I could ask the law department for something. Sure.
Yeah, because that comes up every year, obviously, what we can use it for and what we can't. And am I correct that $15 million has been allocated or proposed to be allocated to the Northern Ave Bridge?
Correct.
Is that for debt service or is that for
the... No, I believe that's design and construction.
Design and construction.
I believe.
So
I have to verify that with Public Works.
Again, trying to get my head wrapped around what we can actually use this for, right? $37 million this year is proposed for appropriation. I think that's probably the most in quite some time.
Correct.
In my recollection. And we'll still leave a balance of about $60 million?
69,
which is significant. Yeah. You know, if we can use it for bridges... You know, what else can we use it for? I guess it begs the question. So if you could forward any language related to that. How we're governed. When was it established? Do we even know when it was established?
A long time ago.
A long time before us. Yes. BU. Okay. Council LaMartina.
Yeah, just a quick question. You said last year the revenue was $16 million in the meters?
In FY, for this year, FY16 would be approximately $16 million, yes.
And how about 15?
15 was 14.6 million.
It went
million.
Down because of the snowstorms and the bridges
yes,
and all
yes, because the year previous to that was 15 and a half. So we did. We took a hit due to the weather last year.
Okay. And then and the tickets, parking tickets had to go up too this year, right? Parking. Issuing the tickets.
Issuance this year is slightly ahead of last year's pace. Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Great. Again, thank you for your good work.
Thank you, Councilor.
Councilor Sabi Joyce.
Thank you so much for participating in round two of our questions. These questions that I have for you now are related to Go Boston 2030, and I think that action plan is expected to be out next year. Any sort of preview to what we think some of the themes or findings might be?
Sure. The final report will be out this fall.
Okay.
So.
And there isn't any sort of budget to support that. So if we're expecting it out in the beginning of fiscal year, the first half of fiscal year 17, we'll see some sort of funding for fiscal year 18?
So when we release the action plan later this year, after an additional community process that will be held in May and June, we will have a set of recommendations that will inform our upcoming capital plans. So for FY18, FY19, and so on. So there will be a direct relationship between the projects that are identified or policies that are identified in Go Boston 2030 to subsequent capital investment plans for the city.
And there's no room for maybe doing some funding, having some funding available to get a jump start on any of these activities or plans.
From what I understand, again, it's informing basic projects that the department would be doing. So it will be part of our ongoing capital investment plan that we put in every year.
Okay, that's fine. So we're going to continue to wait for that action plan to see sort of real outcomes or real productivity. Regarding the hubway, I know that there's some questions with the geography on the hubway as it relates to Mattapan. Is that the same concern for it to ever grow to East Boston? It's simply a matter of geography?
Yes, it is, Councillor. We do have plans to begin those expansion efforts in East Boston. Again, it's an issue of having a network of hubway stations that we can install so that when we do install stations that they're in areas that would encourage usage as well as areas that have the infrastructure to support safe bicycling. So we are actively exploring expansion to East Boston.
Great. And then any active maintenance plan for bicycle infrastructure as roadways get torn up, remarking road, whether it's shared, whether it's, repainting the lanes, all that sort of stuff.
Absolutely, Councillor. That's part of the budget for Boston Bikes maintenance.
All right, that's, I'm good. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Counselor.
Does anyone else have any questions before I go to public testimony? Yeah, sure.
Oh, thank you,
Counselor Presley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just a statement and then a couple of quick questions. And again, thank you. It's been, you know, very thorough. And any additional questions, I'll just follow up offline. You're always very responsive. So I wanted to just reiterate, picking up on Councilor Flaherty's comments, my support for the full funding for the Center South Street streetscape. I, like I said, I did come in late. I didn't know if there was something you might offer in terms of the status of that currently.
Thank you, Councilor. So there's a section of Center South that the Hyde Square to Jackson Square area that's going to see, that's been designed, there's a final design for it, and the Public Works Department is proceeding towards construction for that section. So that's the current funding that we have for that entire corridor. For Monument Square, we have a design that's been completed. Is basically doing some pedestrian safety improvements and putting a new signal.
So this is not in this year's fiscal, this is not in FY17 currently?
No, the Hyde Square to Jackson Square is under construction. So it's absolutely in the Public Works budget. So that's happening.
Okay.
And you know.
Okay. All right, thank you. And then I just, a couple other questions. In terms of hubway use, are we also tracking who is riding, not just the neighborhoods? But I've read a number of studies that have supported that. And you know, maybe you might think I'm biased, but the data says this, that as goes women, so goes the rest of the cycling community, that when women feel it is safe to cycle, then their children, they will bring their children and they will encourage, you know, others in their household and in their life to also cycle. So, you know, we know that in order for us to increase cycling, it first has to feel safe, and we have to reduce those stressful experiences for riders, which is why I'm so passionate about not just the painted lanes, but, mm-hmm. you know, those real protective barriers and also cycle tracks so that families can bike together and, you know, all of that. So could you speak a little bit to that in terms of, are we tracking who is actually riding? So from an equity standpoint, we're making the right investments.
I can get back to you on demographic data that we have on hubway usage. Boston Bikes does have a women's bike clinic that they conduct periodically in the neighborhoods. I think they were in East Boston, or they have one scheduled for East Boston. They were in Mattapan. They're throughout the community. They've been extremely successful. And we welcome any suggestions on where we can go.
Yeah, and I'm interested in you know, gender, race, demographics, and neighborhood, because I will say, I think a lot of times when we're making investments, first and foremost, it is about public safety. That's the number one priority. And then beyond that, when we think bike to work, I think sometimes we're only thinking about neighborhood to downtown, mm-hmm. but, you know, people in low-income communities are usually working within their community, and I don't want us to lose the opportunity to increase ridership. It's the most affordable, you know, thing, but I want us to make sure that we're as invested in supporting people in biking to work or biking within the neighborhood, not just neighborhood to downtown.
Point well taken, Counselor. We will certainly get back to you on whatever statistics that we pull from Hubway as well as from other sources in terms of ridership overall in the city.
Okay. And then I wanted to just ask about at Ashmont, there is a huge protected bike rack structure there next to the Ashmont T, and the usage is very low. And I know people fought for a long time for that, you know, and... you know, I'm not advocating to tear it down, but it seems that since usage is so low and there are neighborhoods and transit hubs that might have a greater use for that, is that something, have you received any feedback on that or any thoughts on that?
No, but we will certainly take a look at those numbers, Counselor, and loop back with your office on that.
I've never seen more than five bikes at a time, and I've spoken, you know, and we have a bike repair shop right there and lots of cyclists in Dorchester, but I don't know if it's that they're not aware it's there. It seems like it would make sense since it's at a major transit hub.
The MBTA has been installing them at several of the stations. So that must be the reason why it's not installed by us. I know that.
Okay. All right. Well, I think that is it for me. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Councilor LaMartina?
Thank you. Commissioner, just one last question. A little concerned about the traffic Sullivan Square with the new proposed casino. I hear that the state, BTD, and the casino have been meeting. Can you just update briefly, or we could do this at my office later or something? I'd like to know what's going on with that.
We have been part of the Lower Mystic Regional Task Force that's convened by the Secretary of Transportation. That effort is being led by Jim Galluli on the Transportation Department side. Mm-hmm. We can certainly send you a detailed update on where we are with that task force and what the status is
with that corridor.
Thank you, Councillor.
Thank you. So that concludes this portion of today's hearings. I have two people that have signed up to testify, Kevin Maloney and Rosemary Jones. If you want to make it down to this desk right here, there's a microphone at the desk.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Kevin Maloney. I live at 20 Rambler Road in Jamaica Plain, and I'm here as chair of the Jamaica Plain Neighborhood Council. And also, oddly enough, one of those rare occasions where the Jamaica Plain Neighborhood Council, Jamaica Plain Business and Professional Association, JP Center South Main Streets, Sumner Hill Association, and the Jamaica Pond Association, the major organizations that cover Center and South Streets from High Square to Forest Hills, are all on the same page. We all agree that we should support the Transportation Department and working through the Ways and Means Committee to find a way to get the money to fully fund the completion of the design work for streetscape improvements from High Square to the Soldiers Monument to Forest Hills. Right now, we're told by the Transportation Department that there's funding to complete construction documents for streetscape improvements from Jackson Square to Hyde Square, but they don't have funding to do anything else between Hyde Square and Forest Hills. Now, Center Street from Jackson Square through Hyde Square to the Soldiers Monument and South Street from the Soldiers Monument to Forest Hills is basically the major route through Jamaica Plain. All the Jamaica Plain neighborhoods interact with Center and South Street. We all think, and when I say we, it's all of those organizations, that it would be very unfortunate, to put it mildly, that improvements are made between Jackson Square and Hyde Square and not for the rest of the way through. There's been virtually no work other than changing the light bulbs on the street lamps done on the road from Hyde Square to Forest Hill. And the street really needs improvement, and there's broad consensus in Jamaica Plain as to what should be done. Now, briefly, by way of background, several years ago, the Transportation Department initiated a series of community meetings led by Vineet Gupta as to what could be done, what should be done. And then that effort seemed to go into hibernation for a couple of years. And then it sort of came out in the spring of whatever year it was, and another series of meetings were held. And through those meetings, there was agreement, broadly speaking, as to what was broken and needed fixing and what was not broken and shouldn't be fixed. And we all expected that there would be funding available to complete the design. But now we're told there isn't any money either on the operating side or the capital side to do that design work. And so we're banded together, all in agreement, hoping to get the support of the Ways and Means Committee and through the Ways and Means Committee through the whole council. We've talked with District Councilor O'Malley, got his strong support with his encouragement. We met with Councilor Asabi George in Jamaica Plain. We met with Council President Wu in Jamaica Plain. We've worked with representatives of Councilor Flaherty's office and Councilor Presley's office. And we've been authorized to report publicly that they're all in support of this effort. So that's why we're here, and we're asking you to help us help these guys bring to Jamaica Plain what we think Jamaica Plain needs and deserves.
Thank you. Rosemary?
Should I read what's written here, or is it just entered into the record?
Either way. I will make sure these get distributed.
You probably had a long day, so I'll just say, if you get a chance, give it a read. I went through 3 drafts to try to make it concise.
It is very concise.
And I will say this has been very interesting. It's the first city council hearing I've been to. I was sometimes puzzled, but basically I learned a lot. So this was interesting.
Thank you.
And I will just say I'm going to get together with a friend who's got a phone that can take pictures, because there's one thing when you talk about bicycle safety, there are places where ramps have been put from sidewalks where there wasn't enough room for a curb cut. And a couple of people with bicycles have talked about near spills when they weren't expecting that. So I'm going to find somebody with a smartphone, take a walk, and I guess you just report it to 311.
Sure.
Okay. So I won't take any more of your time, but
thank you very much for listening. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And reading.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That concludes today's hearing on the Boston Transportation Department. Commissioner and staff, thank you all very much, and please pass along our appreciation to the good men and women of the entire department. Thank you. This hearing is adjourned.